Hello, and welcome to the Hurricane Utah Adult Religion Class, sponsored by the Hurricane Utah North Stake of The Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. I'm Mike Parker, the class instructor. The Hurricane Utah Adult Religion Class meets on Thursday evenings between September and May to discuss the scriptures of the Restored Church of Jesus Christ. If you live in or are visiting the Hurricane St. George area, I'd love to have you join us. The time and location are available on the class website. Links to the class website are available in the show notes for this video. On the website, you can download my notes, which includes footnotes documenting my sources, this PowerPoint slide presentation, and handouts that I distribute in class. Please note that this YouTube channel and the class website are not official sites of The Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, the Hurricane Utah North Stake, or any other church unit or department. I alone am responsible for these sites and the materials on them. If you enjoy this lesson, please click the like button and share it with a friend. And if you haven't already subscribed, please do so. That way you'll be notified when new content is posted to this channel. In this lesson, we'll be studying the origins of the Jaredite people and their decline and fall, as recorded by Moroni in the Book of Ether. There are 62 named individuals in the Book of Ether. Prominent figures in the narrative include Moroni was the son of Mormon and the translator and editor of the Book of Ether. Jared was the family head of a group that included his brother and their friends' families. The brother of Jared is always referred to by that title in the Book of Mormon. In 1834, Joseph Smith revealed that his name was Mahonri Moriankomer. Why was he called the brother of Jared instead of by his own name? Latter-day Saint Mesoamerican scholar Brant Gardner hypothesizes that Ether was writing this story as it has descended through Jared's line, and therefore the book is a lineage history of Jared, not his brother. BYU professor Daniel H. Ludlow offered another possible explanation. Moroni may have omitted the name in his abridgment because of the difficulty in translating or transliterating the name into the Nephite language. Ether was a descendant of Jared and the prophet who witnessed the destruction of the Jaredite people. Coriantumr II was a descendant of the brother of Jared and the last king of the Jaredite people. Shiz was the commander of a large Jaredite army that fought against Coriantumr. Outlining the events in this lesson, Moroni introduced his translation of Jaredite records and recounted the genealogy of the prophet Ether. He then gave an account of the family of Jared from their deliverance at the Tower of Babel to their arrival in the Land of Promise. The middle portion of the Book of Ether contains a summary of the generations of Jaredite kings. The record concludes with Ether's chronicle of the downfall of Jaredite civilization. Unlike Mormon's abridgment of Nephite history, Moroni's account of the Jaredites doesn't offer many geographic and chronological clues to help us identify the where and when of their civilization. Here's what we do know. The Jaredites predated the Lehites and Mulekites by a considerable amount of time. The beginning of their history is connected to the story of the Tower of Babel, which is traditionally dated to around 2200 BC. Their end date was sometime after the arrival of the Mulekites in the Americas, circa 580 BC, but before Mosiah I discovered the Mulekites, circa 220 BC. Mosiah I translated a stone the Mulekites brought to him, which gave an account of one Coriantumr, the last surviving Jaredite, who lived with the Mulekites for 9 months. We know that the Jaredites lived in the land northward, which the Nephites called desolation, because it was the land which had been peopled and destroyed, which was discovered by the people of Zarahemla. A scouting party sent by King Limhi had discovered this land, which was covered with the bones of men and of beasts, and was also covered with ruins of buildings of every kind, having discovered a land which had been peopled with a people who were as numerous as the host of Israel. The hill Cumorah, where the Nephites perished, was called Ramah by the Jaredites. Recapping from the previous lesson, Mormon, the leader of the Nephite armies, led their last stand against the Lamanites at the hill Cumorah. Before his death, Mormon transferred the Nephites' sacred records to his son Moroni, who pledged to finish the abridgment of Nephite history before hiding his father's plates in the earth. Among the records Mormon had retrieved from the hill Shim and given to Moroni were the 24 gold plates of the Jaredites, which Limhi's search party had discovered and brought back to the land of Nephi. When Limhi's people were reunited with the Nephites at Zarahemla, King Mosiah II used the Nephite interpreters to translate the Jaredite record. The Nephites were anxious to know what happened to these people, and Mosiah II told them at least some of their story, but the full account in the Jaredite record was not revealed to the Nephites because it contained details about the secret combinations that destroyed them. Mormon promised to reveal the full account of the Jaredites at some point, but he died before he could do so. That duty fell to his son, Moroni. Moroni made his own translation of the Jaredite plates and abridged their history onto the plates of Mormon, interspersing it with a significant amount of his own commentary. We'll cover some of his commentary in the next lesson. The Jaredite record included a history from the days of Adam until the Tower of Babel, but Moroni chose to not include that account in his abridgment because it is had among the Jews via the Bible, and he assumed his readers would already be familiar with it. Instead, he began with a reverse genealogy of the Jaredites, starting with their final prophet, Ether, and working backwards to Jared. The biblical story of the Tower of Babel takes place in Babylonia, which the Israelites called Shinar. When the people there attempted to build a tower to reach heaven, the Lord confounded their language and scattered them abroad from thence upon the face of all the earth. The claim that this was the origin of all the diverse languages in the world is an example of an etiological narrative, a legend that explains why things are the way they are. Over 7,000 languages are spoken in the world today, the roots of which go back much further than the time of the story of the Tower of Babel. The Book of Ether appears to confirm that the biblical story has a historic basis, but the confusion of the languages was a local event, not the origin of all the world's languages. Jared commanded his brother, who was a large and mighty man, to cry unto the Lord that he will not confound us, that we may not understand our words. He did so, and the Lord had compassion on them, their families, and their friends, and confounded not their language. Jared then told his brother to ask the Lord if he would drive us out of the land, and if so, where he would command them to go. The Lord commanded them to gather flocks, seeds, their families, and their friends, and to travel north into the valley of Nimrod. The Lord promised them that he would meet them there, and go before thee into a land which is choice above all the lands of the earth, where they would become a great nation. The group departed, bringing with them flocks, birds, fish, and honeybees, which they called Deseret. At the valley of Nimrod, the Lord appeared to the brother of Jared in a cloud. This was to protect him from dying by being exposed to the Lord's full glory. He commanded the Jaredite group to go forth into the wilderness, yea, into that quarter where there never had man been, and he gave them directions. They built barges to cross bodies of water as they traveled. When they came to the sea, the Lord intended for them to come forth even unto the land of promise, which was choice above all other lands, which the Lord God had preserved for a righteous people. The Lord swore to the brother of Jared that whoso should possess this land of promise from that time henceforth and forever should serve him, the true and only God, or they should be swept off when the fullness of his wrath should come upon them. Moroni paused here to reiterate to Gentile readers in the last days that this land is a land of promise, and whatsoever nation shall possess it shall serve God, or they shall be swept off when the fullness of his wrath shall come upon them. People there shall be free from bondage and from captivity and from all other nations under heaven, if they will but serve the God of the land, who is Jesus Christ. Modern prophets and apostles have taught that the choice land prophecies in these verses refer to the entire Western Hemisphere, not just to a specific country or nation within them. Apostle Mark E. Peterson said that the promises of Ether chapter 2 refer to the modern nations of the Americas, plural, meaning North and South America. When Ezra Taft Benson was president of the Quorum of the Twelve Apostles, he taught, America, North and South, is a choice land, a land reserved for God's own purposes, quoting Ether chapter 2, verses 9 through 12 in support of his statement. The Lord brought the Jaredite group to that great sea which divideth the lands. They camped at the place they called Moriancomer, named after the brother of Jared. During this time, the group must have become spiritually lax. After they had been there for 4 years, the Lord appeared to the brother of Jared and spoke to him for 3 hours. The Lord chastened him because he remembered not to call upon the name of the Lord, and the brother of Jared repented of the evil which he had done. The Lord forgave him and gave him a strict commandment to not sin anymore. The Lord then commanded the Jaredites to build barges, similar to the ones they had previously built in their journey through the wilderness to the Great Sea. Each barge was small and light, with a watertight bottom, sides, and door. It had peaked ends and was the length of a tree. Once the barges were finished, the brother of Jared brought some problems with the design to the Lord. There was no internal light, no way to navigate, and no way to get fresh air when they would have to close the door in rough seas. The Lord modified the design of the barges, telling the brother of Jared to make a hole in the top thereof, and also in the bottom thereof. And when thou shalt suffer for air, thou shalt unstop the hole thereof and receive air. And if it be so that the water come in upon thee, behold, ye shall stop the hole thereof, that ye may not perish in the flood. There have been many theories as to the nature of this design. The text isn't explicit enough to give us a clear idea of how the Jaredite barges operated with stoppable holes above and below. One possibility is that the bottom hole was at or slightly below the waterline and would act as a pump to circulate air through the top hole. This video demonstrates how such a system might have worked.
Hey, have you ever wondered why in the Book of Mormon, there's that point where Brother Jared is about to put the barges in the water to float across to America from the old world, and they don't have any air inside the barges, and God tells him to put a hole in the top and put a hole in the bottom? Does that make any sense? Hi, I'm Steve's brother. You might call me the brother of Steve. I'm going to talk a little bit about Jared's boat.
Okay, so here we see that the brother of Jared goes to work and he builds these barges, and according to the instructions of the Lord, they were small and they were light on the water. Let's see, they were tight. They would even hold water like unto a dish. The bottom was tight like a dish. The sides were tight like a dish. The ends were peaked. The top was tight like a dish, the length was the length of a tree, and the door, when it was shut, was tight like unto a dish. Oh, we better make us a door.
Okay, so the boat didn't look like this, but it probably looked more like a walnut, except that it was the length of a tree. But so, since he says it's tight like unto a dish, I'm going to use just like a dish and snap it on here, leave this side up so you can, you know, see the inside here. And it makes a pretty good boat if it's tight like unto a dish. When you get this thing in the water, you can go in some really deep stuff and it stays dry inside. And so, hey, that's a pretty good way to go a long ways across the ocean. You're certainly not going to get wet.
Okay, so let's make a door.
And Probably a rectangular door, and we'll put a doorknob on it, and some nice hinges. Okay. Now, inside this barge, there probably were multiple layers. You'd think there'd be a false bottom with rocks underneath for the ballast, and then that false bottom be where the animals and stuff were, and then come up a layer, and there'd probably be where the people were, and then you could go down there in that lower section to take care of the animals. Probably food and stuff was stored down there.
Okay, so here comes the tricky spot. And the Lord said to the brother of Jared, thou shalt make a hole in the top and a hole in the bottom. And when thou shalt suffer for air, thou shalt unstop the hole and receive air. And if it be that water come in upon thee, behold, ye shall stop the hole, that ye may not perish in the flood.
Okay, so the Lord said, put a hole in the top. So I'm going to put a hole in the top. I don't know if Jared had one of these, but... Okay. Okay, so we have now the smoke generator inside, and we don't have airflow going through the barge. We just have bad air inside, and it builds up inside. And yes, there's a hole on the top, but that's not going to really cause anything to move around.
Okay,
much.
Now when we put the bottom, the hole in the bottom of the ship, we've attached this column to it. So here's our hole going through, and we have this column here that contained the water. Now I made this much, much bigger, of course, than it would be properly to scale, just so we can see it easily what's happening. And this keeps the water from coming in the boat, because the water level will be the same inside this column as it is on the outside of the ship. Okay, so I'm just doing a little bit of a close-up here so you can see that water column inside there going up and down stays at the level of the ocean on the outside, and that's what causes the pump. Okay, so now as we move the boat up and down, that water column is going to move up and down within our water column, and it makes a pump. And you can see that the smoke is pushed out, and then fresh air is sucked in through the hole. Pushed out and pulled in through our water pump. Okay, now the Book of Mormon tells us that when the seas got too rough, they stoppered up the hole. Now, I don't suppose the stopper looked like this one, but we're going to use this because it should work. Now, the idea is that now, even though we're open on the inside with our water column, we should be able to go underwater, because as we go down and the water comes up in the tube, the pressure will build inside this vessel and won't let the water come up over the top of our tube if we're just dry. Let's try that. So here we are. We're going to go clear under in the deep ocean, all the way under multiple times, and we're still dry inside. Let's take a look and see. Oh yeah, a little bit of trickle there, a little bit of leak. Okay, now of course every so often there's a buildup of raisins or things down in the bottom of the barge, and every so often you have to send your sons down there to clean that out. Well, because of the advantage of this system, they don't have to climb a ladder and go out through the top. They can simply muck out right from here in the barge. Oh, nice little system. Works a lot like the Brooklyn Bridge caissons did. You know, you probably could even fish down through here. That'd be maybe kind of fun too. The Lord then asked the brother of Jared how he would solve the problem of light inside the barges. The Lord laid out the requirements for any potential solution. Ye cannot have windows, for they will be dashed in pieces. Windows would refer to openings with wooden shutters, not glass windows, which hadn't been invented at that time. The antecedent to the pronoun they is probably vessels, not windows. An opening in the side of the barge would have created structural weakness that would destroy the craft on the high seas. Neither shall ye take fire with you, for ye shall not go by the light of fire. Kindling fire in a wooden vessel would be dangerous, obviously, but the primary concern would have been breathable air. The Jaredite barges would have been at least partially submerged during rough seas, for the mountain waves shall dash upon you. And when the hull was stopped, smoke and carbon monoxide would kill the passengers. What's most interesting to me about this dialogue between the Lord and the brother of Jared is that the Lord didn't automatically provide the solution to the problem. He asked the brother of Jared what he thought should be done. Apostle Robert D. Hales taught, quote, "The brother of Jared's answer to this question required diligent effort on his part. We must remember that it is not meet that the Lord should command in all things. Like the brother of Jared, we must carefully consider the needs of our family members, make a plan to meet those needs, and then take our plan to the Lord in prayer. This will require faith and effort on our part, but he will help us as we seek his assistance and do his will." Unquote. The brother of Jared devised a solution. He went to Mount Shelem and melted out of rock 16 small stones, two for each of their 8 vessels, and they were white and clear, even as transparent glass. He took these to the top of the mountain, a frequent setting for communing with God, and prayed, asking first for the Lord's mercy, despite their weaknesses and fallen nature, then for him to turn away his anger and not require them to go forth across this raging deep in darkness. He then presented his petition to God. Ether chapter 3, verses 4 through 5, quote, "And I know, O Lord, that thou hast all power, and can do whatsoever thou wilt for the benefit of man. Therefore, touch these stones, O Lord, with thy finger, and prepare them that they may shine forth in darkness, and they shall shine forth unto us in the vessels which we have prepared, that we may have light while we shall cross the sea. Behold, O Lord, thou canst do this. We know that thou art able to show forth great power, which looks small unto the understanding of men." Unquote. Up to this point, the Lord had always appeared to the brother of Jared in a cloud that had hidden the Lord from his sight. This time, the veil was taken from off the eyes of the brother of Jared, and he saw the finger of the Lord, and it was as the finger of a man, like unto flesh and blood. The Lord touched the stones, one by one, and they began to shine. The brother of Jared fell to the ground in fear. The Lord asked the brother of Jared why he had fallen, and he responded, "I saw the finger of the Lord, and I feared lest he should smite me, for I knew not that the Lord had flesh and blood." The Lord praised him for his great faith and asked if he saw anything more than just his finger. The brother of Jared, encouraged by the knowledge that his God was in human form and could be personally experienced, responded, "Nay, Lord, show thyself unto me." The Lord first asked him for a declaration of faith, which the brother of Jared readily gave. "Yea, Lord, I know that thou speakest the truth, for thou art a God of truth and canst not lie." The Lord then revealed his full person to him. The Lord informed the brother of Jared that he had been redeemed from the fall. "Therefore, ye are brought back into my presence." He then taught him that premortal spirits look like the physical bodies they will inhabit. Ether chapter 3, verses 14 through 16. Quote, "Behold, I am he who was prepared from the foundation of the world to redeem my people. Behold, I am Jesus Christ. I am the Father and the Son. In me shall all mankind have life, and that eternally, even they who shall believe on my name. And they shall become my sons and my daughters. And never have I showed myself unto man whom I have created, for never has man believed in me as thou hast. Seest thou that ye are created after mine own image? Yea, even all men were created in the beginning after mine own image. Behold this body, which ye now behold, is the body of my spirit. And man have I created after the body of my spirit. And even as I appear unto thee to be in the spirit, will I appear unto my people in the flesh. Unquote. The Lord's statement in verse 15, never have I showed myself unto man whom I have created, for never has man believed in me as thou hast, is perplexing in light of the fact that the Lord had previously appeared in bodily form to Adam and Eve, many others during Adam's time, Enoch, and Noah and his sons. One explanation for this was proposed by Kent P. Jackson, professor of ancient scripture at BYU. He wrote, quote, "This appearance to the brother of Jared is the first recorded manifestation of Jehovah in which he appeared and identified himself as the Son. Elsewhere, the scriptures record him appearing or speaking as God, the Father. But to the brother of Jared, he said, 'Behold, I am Jesus Christ. I am the Father and the Son.' The uniqueness of this situation lies in the fact that Jehovah appeared to Mahonri Moriankimer in his role as Jesus Christ, rather than as the Father. Never before, as far as we can tell from the scriptures, had Jesus Christ shown himself unto man. To the brother of Jared, Christ revealed his complete nature, God, who would become man, Jehovah the Father, who would become Jesus, the Son." Unquote. Moroni explained that he only gave us an abbreviated version of these events. Jesus ministered to the brother of Jared, as he did to the Nephites. The Lord commanded the brother of Jared to not reveal to the world the account of his personal appearance on Mount Shelem until he had been resurrected. To prevent it being known, the Lord commanded him to write in a language that cannot be read, and gave him two seer stones, which would be used to interpret his record. The brother of Jared also received a vision of all the inhabitants of the earth which had been, and also all that would be, and the entire plan of creation and redemption, which he was commanded to seal up. This was included in the sealed portion of the Plates of Mormon. We're going to skip chapters 4 and 5 and return to them in the next lesson. The stones the Lord had touched provided light in the Jaredite vessels. Two stones were placed in each barge, one at each end. The people prepared food and animals and launched their barges into the sea. The Lord caused a furious wind to drive the vessels to the promised land. The journey was rough, with large waves and fierce winds. The Jaredites prayed and sang praises to the Lord. After 344 days, they arrived in the promised land, where they expressed deep joy and gratitude to the Lord. The Jaredites began to farm in the New World. When they landed, there were 24 adult males, including Jared, his brother, and their friends, plus women and children. They were taught to walk humbly before the Lord. They multiplied and spread out upon the face of the land. When Jared and his brother were old and close to death, they gathered all the people together to count them. The people wanted to establish one of their sons as a king. The brother of Jared was worried this would lead them into captivity, but Jared convinced him to permit it. Of the sons of Jared and the brother of Jared, only Orihah, Jared's youngest son, was willing to become the leader of the Jaredite people. Orihah was anointed king, and the people prospered and walked humbly before the Lord. Jared and his brother both passed away. Including Jared, 30 generations of Jaredites are documented in the Book of Ether. Orihah, the son of Jared, was righteous. Kib, the son of Orihah, was also righteous. Kib's rebellious son, Korihor I, took his father captive. After many years, Kib's youngest son, Shul, went to battle with his brother, Korihor I, and he successfully restored his father to the throne. Shul, the son of Kib, was righteous. In the days of Shul, the Jaredites were divided into two kingdoms. Noah, a son of Korihor I, fought his uncle Shul twice, first gaining a part of his kingdom, then later imprisoning him. Before Noah could put Shul to death, Shul's sons assassinated Noah and restored their father to the throne. Korihor II, the son of Noah, battled his great-uncle Shul and was killed. Korihor II's son, Nimrod, surrendered the kingdom to Shul, and the Jaredites were united again. In the days of Shul, prophets came among the Jaredites, prophesying that the wickedness and idolatry of the people was bringing a curse upon the land, and they should be destroyed if they did not repent. The people mocked the prophets, but Shul protected the prophets by decree. The people repented, and prosperity followed. Omer, the son of Shul, was righteous. During his reign, secret combinations were introduced among the Jaredite people. Omer's son, Jared III, rebelled and established his own kingdom. He then made war against his father and took him captive. While in captivity, Omer had two sons, Esrom and Coriantumr I. After they had grown, these two sons raised an army against their older brother, Jared III, and defeated him, but kept him alive, probably as a vassal ruler under their father, Omer. Jared III's daughter wanted to restore her father as an independent ruler, so she proposed a plan. She would dance for a man named Achish. Achish would desire to marry her, and Jared III would then give his daughter to Achish on the condition that Achish brought him the head of Jared III's father, King Omer. Her plan worked. All of Achish's kinsfolk swore to help him kill Omer, and whoso should divulge whatsoever thing Achish made known unto them, the same should lose his life. This was the introduction of secret combinations into Jaredite society. In his commentary on this part of Jaredite history, Moroni condemned secret combinations, which are had among all people, and caused the destruction of both the Jaredites and the Nephites. He warned the Gentiles in the last days that whatsoever nation shall uphold such secret combinations to get power and gain until they shall spread over the nation, behold, they shall be destroyed. And whoso buildeth them up seeketh to overthrow the freedom of all lands, nations, and countries, and they bringeth to pass the destruction of all people. The Lord warned Omer in a dream about the plot on his life, and he fled with his family east to the seashore. Jared III became king, and he gave his daughter to Achish, as he had promised. Achish then had Jared III murdered, and took the throne as the husband of the daughter of the slain king. Achish, fearful that his own son might try to overthrow him, had him thrown into prison and withheld food from him until he starved to death. Nimrah, another son of Achish, was angry at his father for his brother's death, so he aligned himself and his band with Omer. Achish's remaining sons battled their father for control of the kingdom, and all but 30 people in his kingdom were killed. Omer was thus restored to the throne. Emer, the son of Omer, was righteous. Under his rule, the Jaredites prospered in agriculture, livestock, and material possessions. Emer himself personally saw the Lord. Coriantum I, the son of Emer, was righteous. He built many cities. He reportedly died at age 142 after finally having children by his second wife. Com I was the son of Coriantum I. He was murdered by his son, Heth I. Heth I, the son of Com I, was unrighteous. He gained the throne by murdering his father. He embraced secret combinations and had the prophets killed. Because of this, a great dearth, or famine, came upon the land, along with an infestation of poisonous serpents. Some people managed to escape into the land southward, the land the Nephites would call Zarahemla. But the Lord used the serpents to block the way so others could not leave. The famine became so bad that people were forced to eat the carcasses of dead animals. The people repented and humbled themselves sufficiently that the Lord ended the famine, but Heth the First had already died because of it. Shez the First, the son of Heth the First, was righteous. He rebuilt the kingdom ruined by his father. His son, Shez the Second, rebelled against him, but a robber murdered him before he could overthrow his father. Riplakish, the son of Shez the First, was unrighteous. He engaged in unauthorized polygamy and laid heavy taxes upon his people to build many spacious buildings, an exceedingly beautiful throne, and many prisons. Those who wouldn't pay taxes were imprisoned, and those who wouldn't work were put to death. He afflicted the people with his whoredoms and abominations. After reigning for 42 years, the people rebelled against Riplakish and killed him. Morianton I, a descendant of Riplakish, was unrighteous. After the space of many years, without a king in the land, he gathered together an army of outcasts, and after a war lasting many years, he did establish himself king over all the land. Despite being a just and fair king under whose reign the people prospered, he personally was unrighteous and was cut off from the presence of the Lord. Kim, the son of Morianton I, was unrighteous. He was taken prisoner by his unnamed brother and died in captivity. Levi II, the son of Kim, was righteous. He was a captive like his father for over four decades before rebelling and taking back his father's kingdom. He followed the Lord, and the people prospered. Korum, the son of Levi II, was righteous. He did that which was good in the sight of the Lord all his days. Moroni told us nothing about Kish, the son of Korum. Lib I, the son of Kish, was righteous. He eradicated the poisonous serpents and opened the land southward for hunting. During his reign, the Jaredites were industrious and prospered, and never could be a people more blessed than were they, and more prospered by the hand of the Lord. Hearthom was the son of Lib I. After reigning for 24 years, he was taken captive by an unknown usurper. His descendants for the next four generations also lived in captivity. Heth the Second, the son of Hearthom, Aaron the Second, the son of Heth the Second, and Amnigdah, the son of Aaron the Second, lived their entire lives in captivity. Coriantum the Second, the son of Amnigdah, also lived his entire life in captivity. Com the Second, the son of Coriantum the Second, was righteous. He regained half of the kingdom held by his great-great-great-grandfather, Hearthom. 42 years later, he went to battle against the usurper king, Amgid, and regained the other half. He was not successful in eliminating robbers and their secret combinations, and his people rejected the prophets, but Com II protected his people, and he was blessed. Shiblon's name is misspelled Shiblom in chapter 11 of all printed editions of the Book of Mormon. He was the unrighteous son of Com II. A great civil war erupted when Shiblon's unnamed brother rebelled against him. Prophets came testifying of a great curse and a great destruction that would come upon the land and its people, and their bones should become as heaps of earth upon the face of the land, except they should repent of their wickedness. Shiblon had these prophets put to death. Wars, contentions, famines, pestilences, and great destruction came to pass. The people began to repent, and Shiblon was slain. Seth the Second was the son of Shiblon. He lived his entire life in captivity. Ahah, the son of Seth the Second, was unrighteous. He did all manner of iniquity in his days, by which he did cause the shedding of much blood. Etham, the son of Ahah, was unrighteous. He also did do that which was wicked in his days. Many prophets forewarned of great destruction, but the people refused to listen, so these prophets withdrew from among the people. Moron, the son of Etham, was unrighteous. A secret combination against Moron resulted in a rebellion, and he lost half of his kingdom for many years. He managed to recover it, only to lose all of it to a descendant of the brother of Jared. Moron died in captivity. Coriantor was the son of Moron. He lived his entire life in captivity. Many prophets in his day warned of destruction if the people did not repent, but they were rejected because of the secret society and wicked abominations among the people. Ether, the son of Coriantor, was righteous. Ether was a prophet, not a king. Coriantumr II, a descendant of the man who overthrew Moron, Ether's grandfather, ruled during Ether's time. Ether could not be restrained because of the Spirit of the Lord which was in him, and he cried repentance unto the people all day long. He did prophesy great and marvelous things unto the people, which they did not believe, because they saw them not. We're going to skip the rest of chapter 12 and return to it in the next lesson. The people rejected Ether because he taught that the land where the Jaredites dwelt was a choice land above all other lands, a chosen land of the Lord. Wherefore the Lord would have that all men should serve him who dwell upon the face thereof. Ether saw the days of Christ, meaning Christ's second coming, when the new Jerusalem, a holy city unto the Lord, should come down out of heaven and be built up upon this land, meaning the Western Hemisphere, as a dwelling place for the remnant of the seed of Joseph. Those who will dwell in this celestial city will be they whose garments are white through the blood of the Lamb. John the Revelator also prophesied of the city of New Jerusalem, as did Jesus Christ when he visited the Nephites. In the latter days, the Lord revealed to Joseph Smith that the city would be a land of peace, a city of refuge, a place of safety for the saints, and that it would be in the land of Missouri, near Independence, which is the center place. The people in Ether's day rejected him and cast him out. He went into hiding in the cavity of a rock by day, and by night he went forth, viewing the destructions which came upon the people. In the time of Ether, Coriantumr II, who I will simply refer to as Coriantumr from here on, was king over all the land. He was a wicked man who had devoted himself to the arts of war and all the cunning of the world. A great war broke out between Coriantumr and the mighty men who sought to destroy him. None of the parties involved in the war were righteous, and many participated in secret combinations. In the second year of the war, the Lord told Ether to go and prophesy unto Coriantumr that, if he would repent and all his household, the Lord would give unto him his kingdom and spare the people. If he would not repent, only he would remain alive to see the prophecies of destruction fulfilled. Coriantumr did not repent, and he tried to kill Ether. The rest of the book of Ether documents the fulfillment of Ether's prophecy. Coriantumr and his family fought against Shared and were victorious, but Coriantumr was wounded in battle. During the next 2 years, all the people upon the face of the land were shedding blood, and there was none to restrain them. Because of the iniquity of the people, a curse fell upon the land, in which, if a man should lay his tool or his sword upon his shelf, or upon the place whither he would keep it, behold, upon the morrow, he could not find it. Therefore, every man kept the hilt of his sword in his right hand, in the defense of his property, and his own life, and of his wives and children. This curse of a person's possessions becoming slippery was the same that afflicted the Nephites in Mormon's time. Coriantumr's force fought against Gilead, Shared's brother. Gilead took the throne temporarily, but he was murdered by his high priest. The high priest himself was then murdered by a secret combination, and Lib II became ruler of the Jaredites. Coriantumr went to war with Lib II. The two armies engaged in a running battle that ranged all across the northern part of Jaredite lands. Coriantumr's forces eventually defeated and killed Lib. Coriantumr was wounded in the arm. Lib II's brother, Shiz, pursued Coriantumr's army, capturing and burning many cities and killing women and children. The fear of Shiz went throughout all the land, and the people were divided between the two opposing forces. The war spread so rapidly that the whole face of the land was covered with the bodies of the dead, and no one was left to bury them. The smell of rotting corpses covered the land. Shiz continued his pursuit of Coriantumr. Eventually, the two opposing forces encamped in separate valleys. Three times they engaged in battle, and three times the forces of Shiz were repelled. On the third battle, Shiz wounded Coriantumr so badly that he fainted from the loss of blood. Moroni noted somberly, "And thus we see that the Lord did visit them in the fullness of his wrath, and their wickedness and abominations had prepared a way for their everlasting destruction." After he had recovered from his wounds, Coriantumr remembered Aether's prophecy and reflected on the nearly 2 million Jaredite soldiers who had been killed, along with their wives and children. He began to repent of the evil which he had done. He began to remember the words which had been spoken by the mouth of all the prophets, and he saw them, that they were fulfilled thus far, every whit, and his soul mourned and refused to be comforted. Coriantumr wrote a letter to Shiz, offering him the throne if he would spare the lives of the people. Shiz accepted his terms, on the condition that Coriantumr would give himself up so Shiz could kill him. This inflamed both sides, and hostilities resumed again. The two armies engaged in another running battle that ended at the hill Ramah, the same hill the Nephites called Cumorah. For 4 years, Aether watched as the two sides gathered together all the remaining Jaredites for one last decisive battle. Men, women, and children were all armed and participated in the last battle between the forces of Shiz and Coriantumr. After 2 days of fierce combat and 2 nights of mourning and wailing for the dead, Coriantumr again offered to give the throne to Shiz if he would end the war. But behold, the Spirit of the Lord had ceased striving with them, and Satan had full power over the hearts of the people. Shiz refused, and the battle raged for 6 more days, until everyone but Shiz and Coriantumr was dead, and Shiz had fainted from the loss of blood. Coriantumr leaned on his sword and rested for a little, and then he smote off the head of Shiz. The decapitated Shiz raised up upon his hands and fell, and after that he had struggled for breath, he died. Coriantumr then fell to the earth as if he were dead. Dr. M. Gary Hadfield, professor of pathology, neuropathology at Virginia Commonwealth University's Medical College, explained what caused Shiz's unusual response after being decapitated. Quote, "Shiz's death struggle illustrates the classic reflex posture that occurs in both humans and animals when the upper brainstem, midbrain mesencephalon, is disconnected from the brain. The extensor muscles of the arms and legs contract, and this reflex action could cause Shiz to raise up upon his hands. Of course, Shiz would not have remained long in this position, and he would have bled to death rapidly through the severed arteries that go to the head. The brainstem is located inside the base of the skull and is relatively small. It connects the brain proper, or cerebrum, with the spinal cord in the neck. Coriantumr was obviously too exhausted to do a clean job. His stroke evidently strayed a little too high. He must have cut off Shiz's head through the base of the skull at the level of the midbrain, instead of lower, through the cervical spine in the curvature of the neck." Unquote. Ether and Moroni may have viewed Shiz's reaction as an incredible last act of defiance, which is why they documented it. Ether went forth from his hiding place and beheld that the words of the Lord had all been fulfilled, and he finished his record, and he hid them in a manner that the people of Limhi did find them. He concluded his record with this epilogue: "Whether the Lord will that I be translated, or that I suffer the will of the Lord in the flesh, it mattereth not, if it so be that I am saved in the kingdom of God." We do not know what happened to Ether. From the record of Amalekai on the small plates of Nephi, we learn that Coriantumr survived and was discovered by the people of Zarahemla. He lived with them for 9 months before his death. BYU professor Daniel C. Peterson commented on the importance of the Book of Ether. Quote, "Despite its brief and summary nature, the Book of Ether contributes richly to latter-day understanding of the gospel and the ways in which the Lord acts to teach, discipline, and save his earthly children. Its discussion of the Americas as a land of promise remains deeply relevant to modern-day inhabitants of the New World. Its inspired words and dramatic history portray not only the rewards of righteousness and the penalties that follow sin, verifying the principles taught in the Nephite record, but confirm what happens to a society when it reaches a fullness of iniquity. Most importantly, throughout its pages, but particularly in the account of the premortal Savior's appearance to the brother of Jared, the Book of Ether is a powerful witness and another testament of Jesus Christ as the atoning divine Redeemer of the world." Unquote. That concludes this lesson. If you enjoyed it, please click the thumbs up button and leave a comment below. Please subscribe if you'd like to be notified when new lessons are posted to this channel, and visit www.huarc.org to download these notes, this slideshow, and the handouts I prepared for this class. Next week, we'll review the writings of Moroni that he inscribed on the plates of Mormon after his father's death. The reading is Mormon chapters 8 and 9, Ether chapters 4 through 5 and 12, and Moroni chapters 1 through 6. See you then.